All right, can you guys hear me?
Yes. How are you doing?
Good. How are you?
Good.
Good. So you're Travis?
I'm Travis.
Sweet, man. It's nice to finally meet you.
And then this is my friend Robert and the missionaries. I don't know. Do you know the missionaries? Have you met the missionaries,
Yeah,
like in
I've
person?
talked to them. Yeah, before I left Kentucky, I've talked to them a few different times. Yeah.
Yeah. Did you meet U.S. Marshal Raylan Givens while you were in Kentucky?
No, I did not.
You have any idea what I'm referencing?
No, not really.
That's okay. That's from a TV show.
Oh,
An important TV show. So
I
you
don't.
left Kentucky?
Yeah, I'm no longer in Kentucky anymore.
Why would you leave the great state of Kentucky?
To come to the state of Utah.
Oh, why would anybody go to Utah?
I could say the same thing about Texas too, honestly.
Yeah, but I didn't come to Texas. I was born here, so I didn't like find it.
I didn't really find Utah either. It was already there before I got here.
No, but you've willingly chosen to live there.
Yeah, I did. I
So what
sure
brought you to
did.
Utah?
To plant a church.
Oh,
Yeah.
how's that going for you?
It's going slow because they have a whole process they put me through. So they don't just let anybody build up churches out here. So yeah, it was all a process I have to go through and everything else. So it's probably going to be a while before I actually get to do that. So not for right now. I'm just living here and doing evangelism. That's all I'm doing right now.
Oh. Who's the they that control whether you can plant or not?
So I'm doing it through an organization called NAM, but right now specifically I'm with a church that plants other churches, so they're Gospel Grace Church. They have a whole system on how to plant churches, and it works efficiently and it works very well. So yeah, they're the ones who actually get to decide if I can get to plant or not because they're over it. So
He's an Armenian or Reformed Protestant church.
It's not reformed in the name because obviously if you put
Yeah, but
reformed,
I'm talking about theology here.
yeah, reformed, yeah. So that's what I'm doing it through, and yeah, it'll be a while before I get to plant. So, but I mean, nevertheless, like I'm here living in Utah at the moment. So,
Okay. Yeah, I don't know much about how that works within denominations and how they quote plant churches. You can't just
yeah.
so here in Texas, people just rent space in a strip mall and throw up a sign and they planted a church.
It either happens one or two ways. Either you replant a church, you take an existing church that's dying, and you pretty much breathe life back into that church, and you pour life back into that church that's dying, and you help that church continue to grow. And that church will usually take over. Whoever plant is replanting that church will become the new leadership of that church because obviously the old leadership wasn't working. Or you start from the ground up and you have to find a place. Or you have to, like you said, rent out a place, and then that church grows from there. And so technically, yeah, it's planting a church. So it really happens in one or two ways. Right now there's a guy at the church that is he's about to replant a church. So he's about to take an existing church that is dying and almost dead and basically breathe life onto that thing right now. And hopefully that church will grow, and hopefully God will use that church to make more disciples.
So
So
what tonight, what did you want to talk about tonight as far as the topic is concerned?
I don't know. The last time I was not able to do it, Cole was on with you guys. So really I was going to ask you guys what you guys want to talk about because I wasn't the one that was here last time. So really I don't know exactly where you guys left off at, what you guys exactly all talked about and that kind of thing. So
We were basically discussing the nature of justification, early patristic witness to soteriology, and also briefly touched upon Hebrews 6 and 10 and related texts vis-a-vis eternal security or perseverance of the saints that are and baptism of regeneration.
okay, yeah. If you want to talk about that, we can. If you want to move on to a different, I don't know how strenuous the conversation was in terms of the topic. I don't know how lengthy it was. If you guys want to talk about that, I'm down to talk about that. If not, we can talk about anything else. There's all kinds of different topics of theology that we can talk about. So,
well, I'd like to talk about sola scriptura and other issues related to epistemology, if that's okay. But I'm not sure if Travis or others want to discuss that.
Oh, that's fine.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. That works for me. Yes. I don't know exactly like Travis and your name's Brian, right?
Robert.
I'm so sorry. So you guys can kind of tell me where you guys are landing on sola scriptura and kind of what your issues are with sola scriptura. And maybe we can try to hash it out. Then we can kind of go from there and see where the conversation takes us.
Sure. Let me offer you a definition of sola scriptura. You can tell me if it's pretty accurate as to your understanding of sola scriptura. How about that? And then we can take them there. To paraphrase chapter 1, paragraph 6 of the Westminster Confession of Faith and the London Baptist Confession of Faith, all things necessary for God's glory, man's salvation, faith, and life is contained in the Holy Scriptures. And in Protestantism, Holy Scriptures is exhausted and is defined by the 66 books of the Protestant canon, 39 old, 37 new, until which 9 at any time is to be added, whether by new revelation or any other means as well. So that's not a case of toto solo scriptura, to borrow from Madison's phrase. You know, there is such thing as tradition, there is such thing as ecclesiology, but at the same time, outside the realm of the 66 books of the Protestant canon, 9 is God breathed or to produce us, and 9 can be put on the same functional level in terms of revelation or authority than anything outside the 66 book Protestant canon. How would you agree with that definition, or would you want to add anything to that?
Looks like you I'm actually looking at it right now. I don't have it open before me, but yeah, it looks like you quoted a good portion of it. So yeah, if you're quoting from the Westminster, I'm down for it. The only thing in the Westminster I don't agree with is infant baptism. That's it. So it looks like you nailed it on the head pretty good.
Yeah, I have a photographic memory. So would you agree with the thesis that there's no biblical text can maybe I should ask this. For sola scriptura to be operative as the singular rule of faith or the ultimate rule of faith, there must first be tota scriptura, that is, all scripture must be available to the people of God. And as a corollary to that, during times of special revelation, like when the Old Testament was being altered, when the New Testament was being altered / revealed as well, there were other sources that were on the same level of authority and inspiration as written scripture.
Yeah, I mean, so when you say of other scriptures, what other scriptures are you exactly speaking of? Are you speaking of like Enoch and Thomas and...
Maybe I should rephrase. Sola scriptura means that the 66 books of the Protestant canon exhaust the category of the Word of God. So, however, for sola scriptura to be operative as the rule of faith, you must first have the totality of scripture, i.e. all 66 books. I'm just talking about within the Protestant epistemology and worldview. So would you agree with, say, James White, Keith Madison, and other Reformed apologists, historical and modern, that during times of special revelation, you know, like when the New Testament was being altered and revealed, sola scriptura cannot be the functional practice of the church. It cannot be practiced until the cessation of the canon, if you will. And as a corollary to that, there were other sources than written scripture, like divinely revealed oral tradition, that was on the same authoritative and revelatory level as written revelation.
Yeah, so basically what I would say to that is, in terms of sola scriptura, coming before sola scriptura, so basically what you're saying is that you can't have sola scriptura without tota scriptura, because basically it wouldn't function right. It wouldn't operate right because the entirety of the scriptures weren't revealed yet. God was still progressively revealing his revelation to his people, which obviously...
And there were other media that was on the same level as scripture at the time.
So Enoch would have been widely read during the first century.
I'm not talking about one Enoch.
Huh?
I'm not talking about like extra canonical texts like one Enoch. I'm not sure if you think one Enoch is actually inspired or not beyond like Jude's quotation in one of the verses. Again, like, okay, let's kind of go through this. When the New Testament was being revealed, like when Paul was writing these letters to like Timothy, the Bishop of Ephesus, the Thessalonians, his earliest epistle being 1 Thessalonians, probably in 49, he had scripture, mainly the Old Testament, but he had also other sources that were divinely revealed and on the same level as scripture, but it was not inscripturated, like oral tradition, because he does speak of oral traditions being the word of God, not simply written revelation, like in 1 Thessalonians 2, 2 Thessalonians 2, and even the basis of his teachings about the Eucharist in 1 Corinthians 11 is based on oral revelation he received.
Okay.
Were those media,
yeah,
if you will, than simply written scripture available at the time, God-breathed and divinely revealed, and functionally they were treated as being on the same level as written revelation at the time?
Yeah, yeah. Okay, now I hear what you're saying. Yeah, so I mean, when you look at 1 Corinthians 15, 5 through 8, you look at the one in Colossians, look at the one in Philippians, look at the one in the other one in Corinthians, just like you said, for communion. Yeah, they began as oral tradition that was believed about Jesus, which mostly really comes down to the death and resurrection of Christ, the divinity of Christ, the two natures, the dual nature of Christ, and things like that. So there was oral tradition, but ultimately, like, I mean, that oral tradition is in scripture.
Where? So just maybe if I just like one or two questions on this, and I'll let you jump in. Would you agree, as a result, using the historical grammatical method of exegesis, which I'm sure you're familiar with if you're going to be like raising up a church, that there's no biblical text can be used to support it, because no matter the text you appeal to, like say 2 Timothy 3:16 to 17, which is the main proof text for it, or any of the other texts like 1 Corinthians 4:6, that when Paul or whomever, like say John in Revelation 22, which is another proof text, when they were writing a time of special revelation, so they could not be functionally teaching, let alone practicing sola scriptura. So of all the active possible interpretations exegetically of a text, there's none that can actually be used as sola scriptura. And let me just quote one Protestant. Do you know who James White is?
Love James White.
Okay, let me actually quote James White then. Protestants do not assert that sola scriptura is a valid concept in times of Revelation. How could it be, since the rule of faith to which it points was at the very time coming into being? And I offer this commentary. By this omission, White has unwittingly proven that scripture, i.e. the Bible, does not teach sola scriptura. For if it cannot be a valid concept in times of Revelation, how can scripture, read the Bible, teach such a doctrine, since scripture was written precisely when divine oral revelation was still being produced? Scripture cannot contradict itself. Since both the first century Christian and the 21st century Christian cannot extract different interpretations from the same verse, thus whatever was true about scripture then must also be true today. If the first Christians, such as Timothy, the Bishop of Ephesus, who received 2 Timothy 3, did not and could not extract sola scriptura from scripture because other media, such as oral revelation, was still existent, then obviously those verses cannot in principle be teaching sola scriptura, and thus we cannot interpret them as teaching it either. Would you agree or disagree with White?
So I'm just going to answer your question with the question so I can really understand you better, because for one thing, you're kind of muffled, so I'm trying to interpret as you're talking. And you just said a whole lot. So I guess my question is, like, so really, like, what is like your issue with it then, basically, is what I'm trying to figure out. Like, what's your issue with sola scriptura? Like, because for most Protestants, like, okay, yeah, like you have the Old Testament, and then you have the 400-year gap, between, before the New Testament, even before Jesus even shows up, and then 30 years later, and then probably, honestly, after Jesus' death, the Gospel of Mark was written, and there's a 30-year gap, because at best it's written in the 50s, at worst it's written in the 60s. So really, like, what's exactly, like, your issue with sola scriptura? I'm just trying to figure it out, because you're quoting from people, but I don't really know your issue. Like, because you can quote from people all day, but I don't know your issue.
Okay. Yeah, so ultimately for sola scriptura, which is the formal doctrine of Protestantism, It's false. First of all, no biblical altar tallers. Two, many of the essential building blocks for sola scriptura are not taught in the Bible. You must go externally outside the Bible and privilege them as dogma, basically. For instance, there's no passage in the Bible, such as the New Testament, that teaches that special public revelation ceased with the death of the last apostle or the inscripturation of the final book in the New Testament, whichever one was that. And that is an essential building block for sola scriptura, because one of the tenets and core presuppositions of sola scriptura is that, of course, God can lead the people of God through the Spirit. You know, he has means and so forth. But public revelation ceased with the death of the last apostle at the end of the first Christian century. That's not taught in the Bible, and it's never assumed, unless, of course, you want a proof text, like, say, Revelation 22 or Jude 3. And there's a host of other things as well. Even James White would admit that, exegetically, none of the passages used to support it, at least in light of this, although I think he's inconsistent, can, using the historical grammatical method of exegesis, which Protestants love, can actually teach it, because it was not the functional or possible interpretation of any of the texts at the time. So it results in cultic eisegesis. You know, and as someone who actually believes, and I'm pretty open about this, that Protestantism as a whole is satanical, this is like the core teaching, if you will, because it is the formal doctrine of Protestantism, the material, of course, being sola fide. So that's some of my issues. Even using a sola scriptura hermeneutic, you can't arrive to sola scriptura and its presuppositions. That's ultimately why I reject it as false.
Wait, did you just say that Protestantism is satanic?
Absolutely. I'm Irish. We've seen the true ugliness of Protestantism. And I've studied Protestantism. You know, I'm the only Latter-day Saint I know who's read Turnton. So, yeah.
So, you're saying it's satanic.
But by the way, you're dodging, because the fact that I think Protestantism is satanical, and I'm sure you think Mormonism is the same, by the way. Maybe if you were to stick to, like, the issue of sola scriptura, and because this is not a minor issue, this is a major issue between Protestants and everyone else, including Protestants of any stripe. In your case, I'm thinking Reformed and Latter-day Saints.
Yeah,
James, maybe explain, what's your basis for accepting the doctrine of sola scriptura then?
So are you guys, like, wanting, like, a definition, or are you wanting, like,
I think the definition of sola scriptura earlier was pretty accurate.
Just kind of building off what you were saying earlier. So you were kind of going through the Old Testament, for example, and that there's a 400-year gap, and then we have the authorship of the New Testament texts, whichever one they're ordered, it doesn't really matter, but they begin the authorship sometime in the first century, right? So with that said, what's the reason that you accept the biblical canon, the 66 texts of the Protestant canon, as a closed canon within the definition of sola scriptura?
I'm just going to put this out there first. There is no text or no scripture that I can give you guys that's going to change your mind. There's not. Because here's the thing, you guys have already, like, you guys are obviously very smart. You guys aren't stupid. So I can sit here and quote from 2 Timothy. I can sit here and quote from Psalms 19. I can sit here and quote from Mark 12. And I can sit here and quote from 1 Peter. But the thing is, like, you guys already know those texts.
And the thing is, like, it engages in eisegesis. Because you mentioned, for instance, like, say, Psalm 119. It's only talking about the nature of God's word. In Protestantism, God's word is only the Bible. However, in the Old Testament, God's word had other media, like Deuteronomy 8, which Jesus quotes in the temptation to wilderness, man shall not live by bread but alone, but by every word from God. At that time, there's, like, other media of revelation, not simply the Old Testament. And also, if you want to absolutize those passages in Psalm 119, that would mean that the Old Testament is formally sufficient. You don't believe that. You believe revelation continued after Psalm 119. You believe revelation continued even after 2 Timothy 3, where it says all scripture, graphe, is theopneustos. But that's only a general statement about the nature of scripture. It doesn't tell you special revelation would cease at the death of the last apostle. It does not tell you what the extent of graphe is. And here's the thing. Paul wrote other epistles after 2 Timothy. If you believe 2 Timothy, as I do, is written by Paul and not pseudepigraphical, and I'm sure you would hold that view as well. So again, you can actually say, well, you guys are smart, but, you know, probably because you believe in total depravity, we won't be able to, like, understand or come to a truth anyway. Maybe we could discuss anthropology at a later time, but you can claim, like, these passages teach it. But here's the thing. Using the historical grammatical method of exegesis, which I'm sure is a Protestant he would privilege beyond, say, typology and so forth, you can't arrive at sola scriptura. At most, you can arrive to like the idea that maybe scripture isn't inerrant and that it's te apneustos, but you're never told what the extent of graphe or scripture is, even in any of those texts. And an interesting, and by the way, I think he probably meant Mark 7, not Mark 12. That's usually the text that's used. But
that's in Mark 12.
Oh, yeah. Okay. The scripture cannot be broken text.
Well, no, there's another one. It's Mark 12, 35, whenever he's. Okay. So, I'll just read.
Oh, yeah. Fair enough. But, like, fair enough. You can use Mark 12 as well. I know the text. But being as a mate, the issue is even using Protestant standards, Protestantism fails on this issue. And it's not a minor issue, like, say, all versus premillennialism and the internal debate when Protestants about this or exclusive psalmody. We're talking about the very formal doctrine of Protestantism. It's the equivalent of if I could disprove papal infallibility and Petrine supremacy to a Romanist, it's that sinful, you see.
So what, for example, 2 Timothy 3:16, 17, for example, what's the argument that scripture would support sola scriptura?
Well, I mean, so again, like Paul says, like all scripture is inspired by God.
What's he referencing as scripture, though?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, at that time, he's referencing the Old Testament. He'd also have to be referencing himself because he understood that what he was writing would have also had to be scripture. But the thing is here
but,
is that...
But he's living during a time of special revelation, so there's extra books written after that as well, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, so it can't be a proof text in context for sola scriptura. At most, it's only talking about the important nature of scripture, but not the formal sufficiency of scripture, correct?
Because really, basically, here's how I see it, is that the trustworthiness and the immutability and the infallibility, the inerrancy of scripture ultimately is rooted in God, is rooted in the one in which it came from, being the Holy Spirit. So basically,
well, one can believe in the immutability, inerrancy, and infallibility of scripture, and even if you want to limit it to the Bible, you can, but that's not sola scriptura. I mean, one of the greatest defenders of the inerrancy of scripture was Robert Bellarmine. Have you ever heard of Robert Bellarmine?
Maybe.
He was the leading Roman Catholic theologian against Calvin, Luther, Chemnitz. He's the guy who wrote the controversies. So one can believe that scripture is immutable, inerrant, infallible. You know, you can basically hold maybe something to say the Chicago Statement on Biblical Inerrancy and put that on steroids, but that's not sola scriptura.
Okay, then describe to me what is sola scriptura then again.
I've already defined what sola scriptura is, paraphrasing from the Westminster Confession of Faith, and you agree with my understanding of it.
Mm.
It's basically the teaching that the 66 books of the Protestant canon exhaust the category of the Word of God, that after the completion of the New Testament, there would be no more public revelation. Basically, to paraphrase from the Westminster Confession of Faith, for God's glory, man's salvation, faith, and life, all things in the 66 books of the Protestant canon, 39 old, 37 new, exhaust that which is necessary for those purposes, unto which nine is to be added by new revelation or any prophetic utterances or anything like that. So while there could be, like, say, lowercase t tradition, you know, and there's the importance of the local church and so forth, none can ever be put on the same level of authority or importance as that limited 66-book canon. For instance, like, say, what, you know, I'm a fan of the patristics, hopefully you are, like, you know, Justin Martyr was awesome, the Didache is a really interesting text. You can glean truth from that even as a Protestant, but at the same time, you can never privilege something that's extra-biblical on the same level, and none of the biblical authors ever had that, even when they had their own reformations, like Josiah, who would privilege extra biblical oral tradition that's no longer extant for the temple worship in Second Chronicles. So again, the issue is not the inerrancy of scripture. One could believe in inerrancy, infallibility, immutability. One can even believe that there's never been any textual variant in the manuscripts, like a very radical view. That's not sola scriptura. Sola scriptura is much more specific as to a number of issues: cessation of public revelation, the formal sufficiency, not material sufficiency, of the 66-book Protestant canon, and a host of other topics as well. That's why it's the formal doctrine of Protestantism. I mean, if it's simply a case of immutability and inerrancy, traditional historical Catholics and other groups would actually agree with that, like the Eastern Orthodox, but it's not. There's more to it. as I'm sure you're more than familiar with, if you have the Westminster or the London Baptist Confession of Faith in front of you.
So, I mean, again, like, and again, like, when it comes to sola scriptura, like, I really, like, if you, so you're quoting from the Westminster, you're quoting from all these other Protestant guides.
And yeah, I mean, because, like, I want to be accurate in my understanding and summary of Protestantism. It's called intellectual honesty.
Yeah, that's great. I'm glad you like intellectual honesty. But I mean, whenever I'm looking at sola scriptura, like, I really don't see an issue. And here's the thing: if I can't, so
no. So see, James, that's kind of dismissive, though. I don't see an issue. So again, my question is, and I'll give you some time, and we'll be quiet while you explain yourself. But why do you accept that? Why do you accept sola scriptura?
Yeah, because, again, like, looking at what Jesus, how he describes it in Mark 12, like, it literally comes directly from the Holy Spirit's mouth. And for me to deny sola scriptura would mean to me to deny the Holy Spirit and to distrust the Holy Spirit and call the Holy Spirit a liar, basically, because ultimately...
False dichotomy.
Yeah, but that's presupposing...
James, how does believing... for instance, like, you don't even believe that Mark 12 actually teaches sola scriptura, because... extra books, like, you're probably correct that Mark was written the first of the Gospels, anyway, was written, but there's Matthew that was in Scriptura, there was the Pauline letters that came afterwards. Here's the thing. Does that mean that Paul, Matthew, Luke, the author of Hebrews, who I believe to be Luke as well, were they violating Mark 12 when they wrote text and presented it as Scripture? Your answer would be no, I'm sure.
Okay. But again, like, see, the thing is like...
So you're saying up a false dichotomy. It's like, we don't reject Scripture. We don't reject the Holy Spirit inspire Scripture. I agree completely. Scriptures take up new styles. And that means both God-breed, but also in the literature contemporary with the term. It means life-giving. So it's eschatological life-giving as well as being inspired. One produces the other. But here's the thing. One can agree with Mark 12 that the Scripture can never fail, that, you know, God's word will not be void and so forth. But you're assuming, one, God's word is limited to inscripturated revelation. It can't be, even during times of special revelation. And secondly, what happened after Mark 12? God still inspired other people to write other texts that are written and are equally theopneustos, if you will, as the Gospel of Mark. So Mark 12 does not do it. And again, it's a false dichotomy to actually claim, well, if you don't believe in sola scriptura, you know, you're rejecting what Jesus teaches in Mark 12, you're denying the Holy Spirit. It's a false dichotomy. One can agree with that, but doesn't result in sola scriptura, which is much more specific, i.e. cessation of special revelation, the death of last apostle, that the 66-book Protestant canon exhausts the category of word of God, and also an assumption, willingness, and you can never prove from scripture, as you can from the other presuppositions as well, is that the divinely inspired oral revelation Paul and others speak favorably about is found exhaustively in the New Testament. There's no warrant to that. So again, sola scriptura is not simply a belief in the inerrancy of scripture or that God does not lie, or a rejection of sola scriptura results in the rejection of the Holy Spirit. Because if that's the case, all the New Testament authors were guilty of rejecting the Holy Spirit because they didn't practice or teach sola scriptura. So again, sola scriptura, and again, I'm sure you're familiar with this. Like, I'm sure you have chapter one of the Westminster Confession of Faith in front of you, as you said. It's much more specific and more than simply scripture is inerrant or it's immutable or what have you.
And
so, well, again, maybe to appeal to Travis of Carson, do you believe that sola scriptura is actually taught exegetically in the Bible?
Well, honestly, by you even, like, so here's the thing. I realized that you gave me a definition of sola scriptura. And so basically, like, the way I see it from here is, Here's what I, and this isn't me backing out from this, but the thing is like, there's no, again, like, there's nothing I can say that we're just gonna refute you the whole time. Cause, like, the thing is, like, you believe in the Book of Mormon, you believe in the Doctrine and Covenants, the Pearl of Great Price, all that, Articles of Covenants, but, like, I mean, again, like, whenever I'm looking at the Church Fathers, like, if sola scriptura isn't true, then that means that pretty much that scripture should still be continuing with the Church Fathers. They never claimed to have wrote anything that they claim to be inspired by God.
That's false.
from Scripture, and they only see it as authoritative. And I mean, you can look at Augustine, Irenaeus, Justin, Ignatius, Clement of Rome, all these different guys. Like they only saw Scripture as authoritative, and I'm sure you're going to disagree with that in some way, shape, or form.
Yes, and I can actually back it up because I've actually read Ignatius. By the way, Augustine's no friend of yours for a Calvinist. He believed justification was transformative. I'm actually going to share something with you. Actually, can you see my screen? Inspirationist language in the Apostolic Fathers?
Yeah.
Yeah, this comes from Lee Marin McDonald, who's a leading expert on the canon. He's actually a Baptist. He himself holds to a form of sola scriptura. But he acknowledges that the authors of the earliest biblical, post-biblical texts, like 1 Clement, which was probably, he thinks it was written in the 90s, I think it was written in the 60s, but also others believed that what they were writing was actually divinely inspired. They did not view divinely inspired texts to be limited to the New Testament. I'll actually quote from the author of 2 Clement believed that 1 Clement was an inspired document and cites 1 Clement, Trinity 3, 3-4, with the words, "For the prophetic word also says, legegar kai ho propheticos logos." These are the usual words that designate writings as inspired. Clement of Rome, again, he puts it in the 90s, I think a case can be made for year 69, told his readers that Paul's letter, 1 Corinthians, was written with true inspiration, 1 Clement 47:3, but later claimed inspiration for himself, saying that his own letter was written through the Holy Spirit, Grammaneas dia tu hagiopneumatos. That's 1 Clement 63, verse 2. Ignatius of Antioch, who died in year 107, also emphasized his own inspiration. "I spoke with a great vice, with God's own vice, but some suspected me of saying this because I had previous knowledge of the division among you. But the one in whom I am bound is my witness that I had no knowledge of this from any human being, but the Spirit was preaching and saying this." So, you know, if you were to actually look at the Apostolic Fathers, as I have, and just look at the literature and scholarship on it, they did not believe that inspired texts were limited to the New Testament or ceased. Now, of course, there's the debate later with, I keep calling him Tertullian in the third century, about Montanism. But even then, you're not going to find any belief that public revelation in some sense actually ended until sometime afterwards. And you're not going to find any of these people who are basically proto-Protestants in view of their view on the nature of Scripture as well. Again, you mentioned Augustine, but that's a bit of an L because Augustine believed in baptism, regeneration, transformative justification, and so forth. So, you know, what Augustine gives, you can take away as well from a Calvinist. I just kind of mention that because I know Calvinists tend to love Augustine for some reason.
We do love Augustine.
Although he taught justification was transformative, he believed in baptism and regeneration, he believed in infant baptism, he believed in purgatory, he believed in the perpetual virginity and personal sinlessness of Mary and a host of other things that historical Protestants would view to be blasphemous, if not idolatrous.
I mean, there's no church father you're going to read that I'm going to agree wholly with. Like, there's just none. Like,
conflict with citing to the church fathers and saying that they don't uphold their own words of scripture, or they don't uphold any scripture beyond the 66 texts of the Protestant canon. So if you can disagree with what they say, then what then is the basis for even citing them, if you can pick and choose
Augustine believed in the inspiration of the apocryphal books such as Sirach and Maccabees as well.
So I like Augustine, but I don't like everything that he taught or believed. So what is it then? How do you make that distinction in your mind?
Yeah, just before you answer that, like even Augustine, like even Protestant scholars on patristics like Alexander McGrath in his book Justitia Dei, which is the most comprehensive study of the doctrine of justification, he admits Augustine did believe justification was not a legal fiction based on imputation. He believed that it was transformative, you know, per his use of the Latin justificare. Augustine's not a proto-Protestant, unless, of course, you want to follow Warfield and he's nonsensical. The Reformation was simply Augustine's doctrine of grace winning out over his ecclesiology. His doctrine of grace was not Protestant at all, except for the fact he did believe in some type of predestination.
I mean, again, like I was about to say, like, all these men are products of their time. So like, even when it comes to Luther, Calvin, Zwingli, Warfield, all these different dudes, like, heck, there's times when I read Luther and I'm like, yeah, I don't think he got that right. Or times I read Justin, I'm like, I don't think he got that right. there's nothing wrong with me admitting. I think there's stuff that Calvin got wrong. And obviously Calvinism gets its name from Calvin. But Calvin didn't get everything right. They're all men who are products of their time, which is why, okay, Augustine believed in infant baptism. Okay, that I don't believe.
Yeah, but James, you're the one who brought up the apostolic.
Yeah, fathers. How do you parse it out? How do you parse it out? Like, how do you decide? So you're reading Calvin, you're reading Augustine, you're reading these theologians throughout history. How do you say, well, I think they got this wrong? What are you appealing to state that?
To scripture.
That's the only thing. You mean your interpretation of scripture?
Right.
Yeah, interpretation of it, yeah.
Okay, so how do you know that your interpretation of scripture is true? Now, let me give you a central issue. You mentioned Luther. Okay, so I've read a lot of Luther as well. Luther believed all throughout his theological career in baptism and regeneration. He also believed, even after he rejected transubstantiation, he believed in a form of consubstantiation. So much so that he actually wanted to go to war with Zwingli about the nature of the Eucharist. If you're familiar with his theology and the Marburg Colloquy in 1529, where he wrote in using the penknife, "This is my body, this is my body." Now, I'm guessing you reject baptism and regeneration, and I'm guessing you also would reject his understanding of the Lord's Supper. If I'm wrong, correct me. So on what basis do you reject it beyond your own interpretation? Is there anything also underlining that as well, like a creed or confession you would hold to?
Man, don't get me wrong. I love the creeds and I love the creeds and confessions. But again, like, I don't hold those as coming directly from God. I don't.
Oh yeah. I know. That's why, like, when I was discussing sola scriptura, like, it can be lowercase T tradition. It can be useful, but at the same time, what is driving your hermeneutic? Because you say you reject, you love Augustine, but frankly, if someone had the same theology as Augustine on the street in Utah today, you would view him as a blasphemous heretic. So, and when it comes to Luther, you said you think Luther was wrong about certain topics. Why is he wrong about baptism and regeneration and his understanding of the presence of Christ in the Eucharist? You would say it's your interpretation of scripture, correct?
And that's what you're going to say. And yeah. If there's, again, like I said, like this, again, this isn't me being a cop-out, but here's what me and the other two LDS guys, Hooper and I can't remember the other guy's name, something I actually like what they do is, if we feel like a topic isn't going to go anywhere, then why sit here and talk about it? And that's not even me being mean. That's me saying that I only have so much time to talk with you guys. I only got to talk to you guys once. But it's like, we're gonna go back and forth with this all day.
Because this is the formal doctrine of Protestantism, and any discussion between Latter-day Saints and Protestants always devolve into this. You know, if we had like a teaching that's not explicating the Bible, you would say, well, my sola scriptura. And here's the thing. You asked if it was any topic we wanted to discuss. We opened up to you. So and this is a central issue. I think you're trying to downplay it here. So, but Travis, you want to say something?
Yeah. So let's say we talk about any other issue. What would be your basis for discussing that issue? What would you use to support your position on the issue?
It would always be scripture. You're gonna tell me, okay, well, you can't really say that because you don't really like you believe in sola scriptura, but sola scriptura isn't logical, basically. So again, no matter what text I run to in scripture to say this is where I'm getting this from, you're always gonna say, well, that's only your interpretation.
No, it's not simply that's only your interpretation. My contrast between you and Luther is like Luther knew Greek, Luther knew Hebrew. As much of a heretic as I believed he was a smart person. Same with Calvin. One can be a smart person, be a godless heretic, in my view. Like, you know, so here's the thing. In a sense, it is, because this is reflective of the very poor ecclesiology, theology of the church within Protestantism, where ultimately if there's any division between an individual and their local community, they'll actually break away from their church and they can actually have that freedom to do such. It's reflective of a very poor anti-New Testament ecclesiology. But it's not simply like, well, you're us dismissing it because that's just your interpretation. I'm more than happy to discuss using the historical grammatical method of exegesis. I know Greek and Hebrew, so we could actually do it if you wanted to walk you through the text and discuss what's its meaning. It's not simply a dismissive, well, that's just your interpretation. Now, at the end of the day, that's one of the reasons why you might disagree with Augustine and Luther. But again, sola scriptura is, I couldn't really get what you were saying about, like, it's not a logic or ism or something like that. I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you. But again, this is the formal doctrine of Protestantism. And when Travis asked you, what is the basis of it? It's not simply scripture. You would limit scripture to the 66 books in the Protestant canon. And again, there's other presuppositions that go into it, like the cessation of public revelation of the dead of the last apostle, which is not in the New Testament, or the belief that everything that Paul or others believe to be inspired by God, such as oral revelation, is exhausted, is to be found now only in the Bible. You know, it was exhaustively completed and recorded therein. And there's no biblical warrant for that. So again, it's not simply, well, that's just an interpretation. It kind of goes into something more fundamental. And again, I will note, according to Protestantism itself, sola scriptura is the formal doctrine of Protestantism. What that is to Protestantism is basically Joseph Smith's claims to be a prophet of Mormonism, or the claims about the papacy in Vatican I is to Roman Catholicism. It's not a minor issue, it's a central issue.
Okay, yeah, but yeah, it is the big issue. But again, like, basically what this is reminding me of right now is basically just like the school I came from, actually where Hooper and the other guy are in Grayson, KCU. I mean, they had the same kind of arguments that even you're making as a LDS guy. And I mean, ultimately,
who is they?
Other you said they were to some of my professors who rejected sola scriptura, some of them who were semi-Pelagianists, some of them who were open theists and stuff like that. So, I mean,
guilt by association.
Well, the issue is, James, is let's say we talk about any other subject. Let's say we were talking about the formal doctrine of the Trinity, the baptismal regeneration. And you say, well, it has to be proven from Scripture. So I whip open my Book of Mormon or the Doctrine and Covenants because that's Scripture. What's your response to that going to be? Because my basis for doing that is the same basis that the first century Christian followers of Christ would have had for adding to the canon, which they did. They would have taken the interpretations of the Hebrew scriptures and they would have drawn from them a parallel in the life of Jesus Christ, which is what formed the basis of their citing the Hebrew scriptures as fulfilled prophecy. They are interpreting those passages in a way where Jesus of Nazareth fulfills those prophecies, right? So they are adding to scripture by interpreting scripture and then producing that. So my same argument would be any deficiencies or lack of clarity found in the biblical canon with respect to specific doctrines is being clarified by additional revelation. So the Jews at the time of Jesus in the first century found themselves disbelieving the nature and the character of the Messiah, particularly as he appears in the man Jesus. And then after that time period, our Latter-day Saint claim is that based on a text alone understanding, there's no progressive revelation to clarify any of these misunderstandings or disagreements in the doctrines. And so that's what our position is. That to me sounds like a reasonable position. So again, like Robert said, and I think I mentioned is that if we disagree about any other doctrine, it's going to be simply arguing what the biblical texts say. And that means that the foundational argument you have to make are the biblical texts, the 66 texts of the Protestant canon, sufficient? And if they are, well, the secondary question would be, and then who properly interprets them?
So you're asking, like, are they sufficient?
Are they formally sufficient?
As sufficient as defined by the creeds, such as, right. Well, the confessions like the Westminster and London Baptist, i.e. that they are formally sufficient.
So like right. You said, you say if I disagree with Augustine or if I disagree with Calvin, I do so based on I read the scriptures and I read them differently or I interpret them differently. That's your basis. Now, from our perspective, if you are claiming direct revelation from God and you are saying that my interpretation is more correct, they're wrong. then certainly your interpretation delivered to you by the Holy Spirit should be scripture, because you are correcting somebody who is incorrect in their understanding. Right?
How's my interpretation scripture?
Because you're disagreeing. So you're disagreeing with other interpreters of the scripture, right? They are interpreting the scripture one way. You are saying they are wrong. On what basis are you wrong? Simply because you have a difference of opinion, a difference of perspective? Because Augustine, as Robert says, he believes in baptismal regeneration. That's not a secondary or peripheral doctrine that doesn't matter. That's a significant doctrine. So if you disagree with him on that basis, what is your basis for doing that? And if your basis for doing that is your exegesis of the biblical text through the Holy Spirit, presumably, then you're saying God is confirming to you that he's wrong and you're right. Correct?
Yeah, but I wouldn't go as far as to say as what I say is scripture.
And why? Why would you stop short of saying that then?
Because there's things that I say as a fallible, finite, broken human being that don't agree with the Bible. There's doctrines.
Yeah, I know, but
doctrines.
But the biblical authors were not always inspired by God as well. You know, and there's like various books in the Bible that are mentioned and are not actually found there as well. I'm sure like Peter preached other sermons and coughed up sometimes as well. So again, what do you? Okay, it's like
cocked up.
Oh yeah, well it's not. It's I'm from Ireland. We can say that. But
I know. I just think it's funny. I don't hear it very often.
Yeah. Okay, it's an Irish thing. But for instance, like to go back, like say your disagreement with Augustine. Like I think your profile picture is actually Augustine of Hippo. But would you agree? Say let's kind of go through this again. If someone comes up to your local church that you're trying to plant and says, I'd like to join, but I believe in baptismal regeneration, I believe in infant baptism, I believe in relics, I believe in purgatory, I believe in modern episcopacy.
Because they left the Latter-day Saint Church.
I believe that Mary is a perpetual virgin and she's sinless, and I believe in praying to the saints. Would you accept me in your church as a full-fledged member?
No.
Would you believe I'm an idolater and I'm going to go to hell unless yours ever pet?
Yeah, but here's the thing.
Like, so are you comfortable with St. Augustine in your views in hell?
No, I don't believe he is.
Okay, so someone can believe in baptismal regeneration, infant baptism, Mary's personal sinlessness, perpetual virginity, pray to the saints, which is an act of idolatry, purgatory, which is a denial of penal substitution, and the host of other hymns. But why aren't you willing to bite the bullet and say Augustine's in hell?
Because I'm
probably in hell.
I'm not. So, I mean, I could say the same thing and say Joseph's in hell.
Go ahead.
I mean, I'm not getting mad. I'm just saying, like, I'm not some guy with just Augustine's picture on my profile picture because it looks cool. It does look cool. But I've actually read them, and I've never seen him utter those things. I've never seen him say those things. And that may just be me not reading enough, but I have. And you can say that probably about every church father.
James, with all due respect, as someone who used to be Catholic and actually attended the Catholic seminary for 5 years, that is basically all throughout Augustine's work. I don't know how you've missed it. If you look at his commentaries, if you look at his devotional works, if you look at his works on the Daltonists or against the Pelagians, he teaches all those things. It's all throughout his writing. So I don't know how you missed it. And he did teach all those topics.
Well, then are you willing to say that all the church fathers are in hell then?
No. You're the one who brought up Augustine.
We don't hold that position.
As relative. I'm just kind of show like you're obviously a fan of Augustine, but his theology would be so anathema to any considered Reformed theology that it's kind of farcical that you would actually appeal to him as you did earlier. And when you also mentioned like Justin and Clement teaching the cessation of any public revelation, if you actually read, which I kind of showed, if you actually go through your texts, that's not the case.
Yeah, but the thing is, like, if he's such a heretic, then why has nobody after ever said anything about it?
No, that's the thing. We don't necessarily hold that he's a heretic, though. You're the one that is saying that the doctrines that he espoused throughout his writings are heretical, they're wrong, it would exclude somebody from membership in your church. So you hold the position that this person believed things that would be anathema to your current theology. And you're saying, but there's also the church fathers, you wouldn't agree with a lot of them on many things. And so, again, the basis for doing that, I imagine, would be your own exegesis of the Bible, presumably under the direction of the Holy Spirit, which means you are actually correcting error. You are serving in the functional role that the first century apostles did, where they are using their writings and their preaching through the Holy Spirit to correct error.
Hold on. My wife is right here, and I'm sorry, sure. But my wife is, and you guys, yeah, we need to leave. No, I'm okay right now. Yeah. I'm sorry. If my wife is at the door, I'm going to tell you guys to chill for a second, because that's my wife. But again, that's not me disrespectful. I guess she's my wife.
No, don't think it is. No, we're fine. I understand that.
That's okay.
But again, maybe it's because, again, like, it's not like when I, first off, like, I'll admit, like, everybody has their bias. But again, I have a lot of the pastors that have pastored me and taught me, we've talked about that kind of stuff. And again, like, if they would not have led me astray to let me believe that Augustine is one of the greatest theologians ever, just for him to be a heretic, like, they would have told me that. And
okay, no. You said you've read Augustine. So here's the thing. Which works of Augustine have you read?
City of God, On the Trinity, and his Confessions.
Have you read any of his commentaries or any of his works against the Pelagians?
Against the who?
The Pelagians.
Oh, the Pelagians. A little bit with the Pelagians. I want to get more into his commentaries. I just have never gotten access to them.
If you go through his works, like, there's loads of volumes in the Shaft series alone. There's loads of very good works as well, if you know Latin in the PL series. But he teaches these doctrines all throughout. You're not going to find any single, even Protestant commentator on Augustine who would disagree with me. He did teach consistently throughout his theological career until his death in 430, Baptism regeneration, infant baptism. He held to a form of purgatory. He believed in the mono-episcopate structure. He believed in the supremacy of ecumenical councils, albeit there's only two when he died. Ephesus was called afterwards. And he believed in a host of other doctrines and beliefs as well that would be considered anathema. For instance, he believed Mary was personally sinless. And against Julian and one of his works against the Pelagians, he exempts Mary from sin. He believed that she was a perpetual virgin. He believed that it was proper to pray to saints in heaven. He also believed in relics. He did not believe in icon veneration, but he did believe in relics. He believed in a host of other topics as well. So much so that, like, the only, again, Warfield engaged in the cop-out when he said the Reformation was Augustine's doctrine of grace winning out over his view of the church. It's very popular, but it's a misconception. And when I was posing that question, I'm just showing to you that if someone like Augustine were to come up to your church today, you would view him as a heretic. You wouldn't allow him to be a full-fledged member, let alone an elder or whatever structure you have in your church. And here's the thing. According to Protestants, you know, the gospel has always been, like, justification being based on imputation only, that there's a real ontological distinction between justification and sanctification, a rejection of baptism regeneration, that's always been held throughout the Christian era. You know, there was never any period where, like, the light was completely off. Yet if you actually look at the apostolic fathers, if you look at the apologists, and you look at even Augustine and his pupils like Fulgentius, they did not hold to anything that could be considered proto-Protestant, you see. And yet we're meant to believe, you know, again, and none of them, to go back to the issue of sola scriptura, none of them believe in the formal sufficiency of the 66 books of the Protestant canon. I mean, Augustine, all throughout his theological career, from his conversion until his death, believed, as the local African synods did, that the Apocrypha was as inspired of God as the proto-canonical books. You know, Carthage, Hippo, Rome, for instance. So again, you're not going to find any proto-Protestants. So, like, the only reason I'm bringing up the patristics is because you're the one who reference, like, well, if you look at Clement and Justin, they did not believe scripture was ever going to be produced after the New Testament. That's not the case. So again, you're not going to find anyone in the patristics, if you actually read the patristics, that are proto-Protestant in the central core aspects of theology. And if you're looking for a book, Alistair McGrath, who is from Northern Ireland, he's a Protestant as well. So he's no fan of Catholics. He's no fan of Mormons. I know that for a fact. In his book, Eustistia Dei, he details Augustine's view of justification and how it was not legal or based on imputation. It was transformative, you know. And the idea of Luther's understanding of faith alone and the nature of justification was an absolute novelty with Luther, and it required nominalism, which was only invented in the second millennium.
Okay. I'm trying not to let food fall in my mouth. So, again, you're saying all these things, but what I've learned is that I'm going to have to go back and do more research, which is what I'm always doing to begin with. I'm always reading. So nothing against you, but I'm not going to take your word for it just because you tell me so. I want to go look at it myself. Which,
please do. And by the way, actually read the Apostolic Fathers.
Okay. That kind of seems like a backhanded comment, but...
Well, I mean, you're the one who said that the Apostolic Fathers did not believe that Revelation was continuing, and yet they would speak of their own writings as God-breathed, as Paul did for his scriptures.
Okay, but if we're going to have a conversation here, I'm going to be honest with you. I don't like backhanded comments.
No, I'm not backhanded compliments. I'm just saying you should read the Apostolic Fathers.
That was, because, yeah, I referenced him, and I didn't exactly even get to really quote from him. But if we're going to make backhanded comments, I'm not going to sit here and do that with you. I think you're a super nice guy, but I'm not going to take backhanded comments from you, because I'm not going to do that to you. I'm going to show you respect, even though we disagree on theology and everything else. But I'm not going to throw backhanded comments at you. I have too much respect for you and any other LDS guy, even though I don't believe what you guys believe. I'm not going to throw a backhanded comment at you. I'm not going to do that. So I'd really appreciate it if you didn't throw backhanded comments at me, because that's exactly what that was. And I've heard enough of them at my going to KCU, the people who are not Calvinists and hate Calvinists, make backhanded comments all the time. I know them when I see them, and that's one of them. So I'd really appreciate it if you didn't do that again. Not me trying to be mean or rude, but I'm not for that. I'm not doing that. So again, we're going to sit here and go back and forth all day on what we believe the church fathers said or didn't say or whatever. Like, again, I knew when we talked about sola scriptura, and you are right, I will give you this, that I'll let you guys pick the topic. But I'll let you guys pick the topic because I had no idea what you guys wanted to even talk about. So again, we can sit here and go back and forth with sola scriptura all day. If there's another topic you want to talk about.
Well, so I have a question. So you produced a video a while back. The missionaries had sent me a link to it when I kind of asked who you were, but you did a video about Mormons and Mormonism. And the reason, the problem with it is most topics will come back to this. I've had a lot of discussions myself with Protestants, especially of the Reformed tradition, but you said, because one of the biggest things I did focus on was how Mormonism, how its doctrines, how the Book of Mormon, how the Doctrine and Covenants, how the Articles of Faith, how all those different things contradicted Scripture. So again, presuming the biblical texts alone are Scripture, and those texts are not Scripture. And here's the thing.
That his interpretation is reflective of the meaning of the text as well. Yeah.
And here's the thing. There have been many books that have come along after the Bible and have claimed to be from God. They've claimed to be the word from God. Well, here's the thing. They can't be from God. You all know why. Because every single one of them, including the Book of Mormon, contradicts the Bible. Any word or any book, any scripture that comes along and says this is from God, but yet you compare it to the Bible and you see that it contradicts every doctrine, every word, every comma from the Bible, then it's probably not from God. It's probably straight from Satan, because God is immutable and God can't change, which means his word can't change. And by word, I assume you mean the Bible. Is that correct? Yeah. So again, the polemic that you're kind of hurling out there with respect to Latter-day Saint theology, especially with our view of Scripture, is predicated securely in the idea of sola scriptura. Can you think of another doctrine that wouldn't eventually lead logically back to an argument surrounding sola scriptura?
Okay, I'll give you this. It does lead back to that. But again, if you look at the Bible, like, I can sit here and call off things about original sin and imputation and the Trinity and Christ's two natures and everything else. Like, still, like, those are other topics. Yes, they do lead back to the Bible, but still, there are other topics within the Bible besides just sola scriptura to pick on and to debate about, and not necessarily pick on, but I'm not saying you guys are picking on. I'm saying you guys are giving your view, and that's great. I respect that. But there's other topics to talk about, because, again, like, I honestly believe, and that's why whenever I talk to other people who are LDS, I don't sit and debate about sola scriptura all day. I don't, because it leads nowhere. And I've even had other LDS guys tell me that, like, this conversation is leading nowhere. Let's talk about something else. And that's not me making it up. That's me talking to a good enough LDS guys enough to know that it doesn't lead anywhere. He just hit a wall.
So what doctrine would you propose then? Oh, go ahead, Robert.
No, but James, here's the thing. Sola Scriptura is the formal doctrine of Protestantism. So it's not a central, it's not like a minor issue. You know, this is Protestantism being tested by its very own claims and basically biblically found wanting. But also, this issue colors, if you will, the interpretive lens or the hermeneutic one has to any of these issues as well. For instance, you mentioned like imputation. If you were to do a lexical study of kashav or logizomai, it doesn't mean impute in the Protestant sense. It means a mental representation of the reality one is commenting on. That's not imputation. So we could like go around about this, but ultimately at the end of the day, it's basically your interpretation versus my interpretation. But
that's my
we have other sources as well. And in your view, you can claim to believe in sola scriptura, but here's the thing: we've seen you can't produce a biblical text that can teach it, because the biblical authors could not teach it, and you can't show us any of the presuppositions informing it are biblical as well, like a cessation of public revelation. We've seen like even the apostolic fathers did not believe that. So here's the thing: it's not a minor issue, like a issue that doesn't go anywhere. It kind of shows, and you know, Protestantism has no leg to stand on. And here's the thing, you know, and I'll be perfectly blunt here: you as a Protestant preaches from what I would view to be a false gospel, and I stand by calling Protestantism satanical because it's evil. And you're trying to like teach and reach Latter-day Saints in Utah with this gospel. I believe that be a perversion. You believe what I believe to be a perversion. But at the end of the day, what you believe to be the formal doctrine of Protestantism, sola scriptura, is actually anti-biblical. Jesus did not teach it, Paul did not teach it, and all the others. And ultimately, it's this doctrine that colors and informs all other discussions. Because you mentioned we could discuss, by the way, I would love to discuss forensic justification with you and how Romans 5 actually eviscerates it, and the same even from the above Romans 4 and its use of Psalm 32. But at the end of the day, you're just going to dismiss what I say because you have the idea of sola scriptura, but also, as we've seen, mediated through your own presuppositions as well. That's why you're more than happy to disagree with like Luther and Calvin. Not because, again, there's other reasons as well, but you would believe that you would hold, like, say, the proper interpretation of these texts or issues than Calvin did. And ultimately, at the end of the day, it's sola scriptura, and also informed by your own traditions as well.
Okay, well, this is just me, and I'm just going to throw this out here. If we're going to go back and forth all day, then what's the point of sitting here and talking about it then?
Well, the point The well, point
my hope is like you'll actually abandon Protestantism and you'll stop your crusade against Latter-day Saint theology. I've seen your YouTube videos, that would be one thing, but I'll let Travis answer as well.
Yeah, so and it would be that, so my opinion is that if somebody holds to something, a belief that can't be supported based on its own criteria, then why are you holding to it? That's why I keep asking the question is, what is your basis for holding on to the idea of sola scriptura other than a dogmatic desire to hold on to it?
Why do you say it's dogmatic? So when I first became a Christian, it's not like I didn't know exactly what sola scriptura was. I didn't even know there was a Reformation. I just knew I was a Christian and I loved Jesus.
Right. Just a quick interjection. One of the things that I wanted to ask you, and we can answer it in a minute, but is if you approach a Latter-day Saint, and I don't know in what capacity or context you're doing your ministry to Latter-day Saints, for example, in Utah, which I assume you must be because of the population of Latter-day Saints there. But so as you approach a Latter-day Saint, let's say you start talking about justification, or you start talking about the rejection of the Book of Mormon as scripture, or our understanding of the nature of God, and you say you guys believe in a different Jesus or some other concept, most Latter-day Saints aren't familiar with the idea of sola scriptura. And so they will go scripture for scripture with you, not realizing that what they're doing is they're engaging in the same fallacy that you're presenting to us, which is the presupposition that the biblical texts are, that all doctrines must be contained within the biblical texts. That is a position that Latter-day Saints outly reject. We do not believe that everything that we believe must be contained within those biblical texts. And so the argument therein is, for example, if you say God is a spirit, quoting from John, and I say, no, he has a body of flesh and bone, quoting from the Doctrine and Covenants, and you say, well, those conflict, right? That would be your position, and that I should reject the one in favor of the other. Even from a very simplistic perspective, which really wouldn't be exegetical, and Robert can kind of speak to this, but it really wouldn't be an exegetical analysis to say that John 4 actually teaches that God is a spirit, that he is a being of pure spirit, that he's bereft of a physical body. I don't think that the biblical texts support that proposition at all, but that ultimate claim could be ameliorated by just the saying, look, the Doctrine and Covenants is a clarifying revelation. It's new information, the same as the New Testament was additional clarification and understanding of the Old. And so that claim is logically sound. It's consistent with history. It's consistent with the development of revelation, that you have old revelations and old understanding. Certainly, nobody in the Hebrew Bible believed in the Orthodox Trinity. That was a new position that was held as a result of the New Testament, right? So the allegation that God has a physical nature, a physical body, that same claim is valid. And so from even a logical standpoint, again, the argument becomes ultimately, yeah, but the Bible alone.
Well, whenever I am talking to someone on the street who's an LDS guy or woman, I don't even get into those conversations with them. For one thing,
you don't tell them that they believe in a different Jesus?
If I'm even able to get that far, because, I mean, to be honest with you, here's my experience. There isn't a lot of time for lengthy conversations. There's just not. If I'm catching someone on the street, which is most of the time how it happens, most people in Utah, they're not like Kentucky. They don't want to come over to your house and hang out. Like, that's just not how it works. And I'm sure you know that.
Like, we have a whole church program that incentivizes people to do that. So that's not been my experience living in Utah, but I understand what you're saying.
Yeah, it's been my experience. And especially coming from Kentucky, everybody wants to come to your house and hang out. It's not that way. So when I'm telling someone the gospel, I only have maybe like, I don't know, at best, maybe 10, maybe not even 10 minutes, maybe sometimes. I sometimes just have to get to the salvation issue and how do we believe someone is saved from that. I don't always have time to get into you guys believe in a different Jesus and a different God and all these and different gods and this is what Joseph said and this is what the Doctrine of Covenants said and this is the King Fault Discourse, all different. I don't have time for that. I just don't. And that's not even me trying to cop out. That's me literally saying that's usually how it happens. Is I usually don't have the time to get into those things because they're either trying to go somewhere, and I understand that, and they're gracious enough to sit and talk to me for as long as they are, or they just tell me basically to go away, and I go away. So, like,
But James, here's the thing. One, this is not a normal setup. Like, you have plenty of time to actually make your point.
I'll give you 10 minutes. Go ahead and 10 minutes to say whatever you want.
Yeah, and two, here's the thing. Again, how you understand the gospel, you know, like imputed righteousness and so forth, it's informed by an albeit prosenized understanding of how to read these texts and these texts alone as being privileged. You know, for instance, I could argue, and I would love to do this sometime, just walk you through, like, say, even Romans, like 4 and 5. We don't even get to 6, which teaches baptism regeneration, that justification is not purely forensic, that it is transformative and so forth. But here's the thing. What informs your interpretation of the text is informed by the various presuppositions of Protestantism about the nature of the Bible, of which sola scriptura is key. That's the formal doctrine of Protestantism. You know, so you can claim like you teach people the gospel. I would disagree with that because I don't think Protestantism has the biblical gospel or even the historical gospel to begin with. But proceeding from that, how you understand, say, the nature of the atonement, the nature of God, Christology, you mentioned the hypostatic union of the dual natures of Christ, that is informed largely, if not completely, in part, by these presuppositions of Protestantism, of which sola scriptura is one. So that's why it's a central issue. And I don't know you think we're not going anywhere, but I think we've kind of shown like a lot of presuppositions of this practice and doctrine is not biblical. For instance, there's no cessation of public revelation being taught. There's no belief or no text that teaches sola scriptura. At best, you can only show that Jesus had a high view of scripture, but everyone can agree with that and not hold a sola scriptura. So again, it's a central issue, and simply because it doesn't come up in conversations. A lot of Latter-day Saints are very ignorant of Protestantism. I'm more than willing to say that, but I'm not, and Travis is not as well, you know.
Again, that's what I'm saying is, again, I will give you this. The issue will always come back to, and I'll admit you're right on this, that it will always somehow or another, the trail will always point it back to sola scriptura. So yep. I will give you that. So I'm not going to sit here and tell you that it doesn't when it
which
does.
Which is why it's sinful.
Which is why I said earlier, like, guys, like, this isn't me being mean or anything. Like, then why sit here and argue back and forth?
Well, because, James...
Because it's a central issue, and like,
yeah,
I'm sure you're concerned about our salvation. I'm concerned about yours. I don't believe a regenerate person would actually embrace Protestantism.
Yeah, so let's say we would. We're never going to agree on sola scriptura. From my position, I would say, but why? Because ultimately, if sola scriptura presupposes tota scriptura, which means that the doctrine must be contained within the text, and yet no exegetical analysis of any text will support that doctrine, then as a Latter-day Saint, I would say, well, then why would I believe that? But let's set that aside. Let's say you and I meet at a bus stop. I shake your hand and say, hi, I'm Travis, I'm James, I'm a Latter-day Saint, and you're trying to spend some time to, I guess, save me, because I assume that you believe Latter-day Saints are destined for hell.
Yeah, but I don't think I can save you. That's the thing. Like, I don't think I can save you.
No, and I don't think you could either, but I mean, and that was partly one of the questions I wanted to ask about your position on church planting, but I don't want to get in there, but
well, no, ultimately... I don't
want you to... Travis, I think the expression would be like, they can't save you, but like, I think...
Right.
Of course, you were saying like use as an instrument to bring about salvation.
Like, yeah. So you're an instrument for, so for example, like a person comes into a church. This is kind of what I was thinking as you were saying that. A person comes into a church to breathe new life into it. Well, that's not really what a person is doing. Presumably, you believe that God is breathing new life through a different individual. But why the other individual was deficient at doing that, I don't know. God didn't like that person and chose to use this person instead, I assume. But that's kind of aside from the thing. You and I meet, we're in the bus stop, and you're being used as an instrument to show me that I am believing in a false gospel and a false Jesus. What would you focus on? What is your argument to support that position, though? What would you start with? Because I'm genuinely curious.
I mean, it would really start with, like you said, me at the bus stop, we introduce ourselves. We only have so much time because the bus is coming, and I'm assuming you probably don't, even though you shook my hand, you probably don't really want to get into a conversation about it at the moment. But
I would, but I'm unique in that respect, and I'm sure Robert would, but we're odd.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Hypothetically, you guys will, most people at the time don't. Really, like I told you guys earlier, like I'm not bringing up the Sola Scriptura or Sola Christus or whatever. Sola, I'm not bringing up that. Literally, my first question would be like, you know, how do you believe someone is saved? And then I would let them explain how they believe someone is saved. And really, depending on how that goes is depending on how the conversation is going to go more often times than not. Because I'm just going to be honest with you, like, even... And this is why I feel like this conversation isn't going to really go anywhere. It's not even being fruitful, because if I honestly feel like that person has dug a trench, and it's not the fact that I'm expecting you guys to give up the conversation. Like, if I feel like it's not going anywhere, then like I'm not going to waste my time. Which is why, like, I've been telling you guys for the past like 10 minutes, like I'm not going to waste my time here, because again, you believe I'm not saved, and vice versa.
We actually don't believe that. So I don't believe you're not saved. I actually don't know. So I don't have a position on it particularly, because I don't believe that we as human beings are allowed to make those kinds of judgments. But even so, aside, so if you talk to a Latter-day Saint, you're saying they're not open, they've dug a trench, but that's presupposing you're correct.
And also, you're reformed, so you would believe everyone who's not been regenerated is totally depraved. And even after they come to saving faith, they still have the noetic effects of the fall. So everyone, no one here is like epistemologically privileged, even in your anthropology.
I mean, the thing is, like, so I run into someone on the street. Again, I don't know their heart, and I don't know if they're saved or not. I have met people who I have never met before on, like, here in Utah, who are Christians. From my definition, that they are Christians, we go to the same church, we believe in the same gospel, and I know you don't believe in what we believe. But again, like, me saying they dug a trench is basically when I've come to the conclusion that, okay, like, they're not going to give it up no matter what. And it's not like I can make them give it up anyway. So it's like, I'm not going to waste my time. And that's why I'm not going to waste my time here with you guys.
No, but James, in your anthropology, only God can actually bring about effectual calling and regeneration, correct? You're right. A Calvinist. So that's the case for everyone. It's not simply like the most entrenched Latter-day Saint or insert group you think is preaching a false gospel here, like a Roman Catholic. I'm guessing you think Rome preaches a false gospel as well, or Eastern Orthodox. Everyone is in that position in your anthropology.
Yeah, I believe that from birth, but ultimately... Yeah,
we're not even discussing the original sin. It's just like, in your view, everyone who's not, in your view, has been effectually called is actually totally depraved. It's not a case like they're slightly depraved, that they're totally depraved. By nature, they hate God. Any good they have is purely grace, and any religion they have is actually inherently idolatry and fake.
But ultimately,
so here's the thing, like, everyone you encounter who's not, in your view, a Christian is already entrenched. We, you know, in your view, we would be, if you're consistent in your anthropology, as is the sweet next door neighbor Mormon lady as well, in your view, in your anthropology.
Wait, I didn't catch that last part.
In your anthropology, your theology of man, everyone is totally depraved, no matter they're, whether they're entrenched or not. So, you know, if you're not going to be wasting your time discussing things with us, you're just wasting your time as well, preaching the gospel. But it doesn't strike me as you're a hyper-Calvinist. So I'm just saying, like, there's a bit of an inconsistency here in your claims, because everyone in your anthropology is totally depraved. So yeah, in a sense, everyone is entrenched, as you believe that we might be entrenched when it came to, like, certain of these topics.
Yeah, like, when it comes to, I literally just forgot what I was going to say. When it comes to being, like, a hyper-Calvinist,
I was saying you're not a hyper-Calvinist because, of course, you believe in the preaching. So I'm just saying, like, there is an inconsistency in what you are saying and your actions.
Yeah, because I do believe that someone can only be saved by God's work alone.
And everyone who is not being effectually called is totally depraved.
Yeah, but the thing is, I don't know if that person's effectually called or not. It's not like God put targets on people's backs.
But that's not my point. Like, your vision has to believe in Latter-day Saints.
You also couldn't sit next to me on the bus and not know that at some point in the life, I am one of the elect. I just haven't yet been regenerated. Future time from leaving that conversation, I would be. So you say waste of time. I don't view any of these discussions. I've literally had hundreds of these discussions with the missionaries, and I don't view any of them as a waste of time because, I mean, if nothing else, I learn a great deal. Because I learn about an individual person and their specific perspectives, which is valuable to me. But even from that perspective, what I'm saying is how are you going to say whatever it is that you say to me as a Latter-day Saint? Because you mentioned, like, the King Follett sermon or the nature of God or different Jesus or something, right?
I did.
Yeah, and so I would challenge you probably on your understanding of what the King Follett sermon is. I assume you believe it teaches that we believe at some point in time God was not God.
Yes.
Okay, it doesn't. So that's the other thing, too, is that you would be misrepresenting Latter-day Saint theology and that sermon specifically if you were to present that. And you may be presenting it to a Latter-day Saint unfamiliar with the sermon, which, just like somebody might present something to you that you're unfamiliar with from your own tradition. And just saying, well, this is what it teaches. They're not aware of it. And what you're actually doing is lying to them. Right? So what of your own theology would you present? So let's say you ask me, are you saved? And I say yes. As a Latter-day Saint, I'm saved.
Okay. Then I would ask you, I mean, so you're presenting yourself as a Latter-day Saint, you say you're already saved. My next general question would be, okay, like, how did that happen? That would be my next question. Like, how did you get saved? That would be my question.
I placed my faith in Christ and I was baptized for the remission of my sins.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and then here's where this will logically go. Which Christ, and then there a wall comes up, and then it'll eventually, like you said, it will come back to sola scriptura. Just like you said, you're right about that. It will come back to sola scriptura because
Let's explore that. So which Christ? And I respond, well, the Jesus of Nazareth represented in the four New Testament Gospels.
Okay, then at that, well, the thing is that never happens. So I really can't even give you a...
Right, and really so my point is it sounds like what you're doing is actually trying to rely on people who may be doctrinally ignorant in the hopes that you can trick them.
Why would I try to trick someone? Like,
I don't know, because the actual official doctrine of the church is we maintain that Jesus is the Christ, the God of the Old Testament, made flesh, and that he is presented as the prophet, priest, and king in the four New Testament Gospels, and the word of his atonement was spread through the ministration of his apostles throughout the rest of the New Testament manuscripts. That's the official position of the church. So that's the Jesus I believe in. In fact, the Book of Mormon maintains...
Just like to build on Travis, because I know Trinitarian Christologies, ultimately, at the end of the day, like, you know, you'll disagree about us, like, about the nature of, say, creation. These are out of Nahin. These are from pre-existing material, aspects of Christology, such as the nature of atonement. But ultimately, it will come down to, again, you know, can we have like extra revelation adding to these things, not necessarily contradicting, but at the same time, again, it will come down to like, say, your interpretation of these passages as well. And on what basis do you get this interpretation? How do you know this interpretation is correct? For instance, we could walk through, say, Colossians 1, 15 to 20, you know, one of the hymns about Christ, but you would disagree with my interpretation. I'm not sure if you can read Greek. I can, but let's just say you can. It's not the case of, say, lack of intelligence or lack of ability. It's going to come down to, ultimately, my final authority. And for you, even if you think it's a waste of time, your final authority is, if you're a historically minded Protestant, which I'm sure you are, formal sufficiency of the 66 books in Protestant canon, alongside how, and but accordingly to that, although it's, you might disagree with it, how mediated through your own lens, if you will.
Right. Yeah.
For instance, let's kind of go like into the gospel. You know, I would non-flippantly say, because I place my faith in Christ, I'm being baptized for the remission of my sins. Yes, this is not like a trick question. Like, there's a bit more to this afterwards. So, yes or no? Do you reject baptismal regeneration?
I say what now?
You reject baptismal regeneration.
Yeah.
Okay. So, you know, if we would have a conversation, you know, by the way, I moved from Ireland to holiday, so if you ever want to meet up for lunch in person, I would love to have that. But so I would say, like, well, you know, I would walk you through, like, say, Romans 6, 3 to 7, you know, and I'm not sure how you would respond to it. Maybe you would say, well, baptism there is not water baptism, it's only being united with Christ, or what have you. Again, you know, I'm sure you're a smart guy. I like to think I'm a smart guy. Again, on what basis can we actually adjudicate this central issue? Because we're talking about the instrument of salvation. And you might claim, well, you know, Ephesians 2, but I would say, well, what about the parallel text in Colossians 2? You know, that mean that interprets the instrument of faith and grace, hey, water baptism. So hey, I kind of get to the point I'm getting at.
Guys, this isn't me trying to get out of this. Like, my phone's literally on 2%. So,
sorry about that.
No, yeah, if we keep talking, like, you may think I hang up on you, so I don't want you guys to think.
No, you're fine. Yeah, you're fine.
Okay, it's fine.
I get it.
Yeah, my phone literally is on, because I think I'm... No,
at a charger?
Yeah, but it won't... Where I'm at in the room right now, like, where I have it set up, it won't reach.
Yeah.
So my phone literally on 2%, so, like, it's literally, like, moments from now I'm about to die.
No, yeah, you're fine. I just kind of, in kind of referencing back, and, you know, and that's the problem is that you say, are you saved? We say yes. We provide an answer that's consistent with, you know, as Robert did with Acts 2, where Peter says, what shall you do? Repent and be baptized, every one of you. So, I mean, for Latter-day Saints, that's going to be a simplistic understanding. We accept Christ through faith, and we submit to Christ through baptism. We repent of our sins. That's our gospel. That's what we understand. And that is effective because of Christ's atonement. Because of his death and sacrifice on the cross, that's why those things work. The water itself doesn't have any effect beyond the atoning blood of Jesus to make it effective. So we're but for example, in the video that you did, you presented 2 Nephi 25:23, which is an off quoted passage, and then you compared that with Ephesians 2, and the problem with that is even in doing that, you misrepresented the context and the meaning of 2 Nephi 25:23. And so my point is it looks like, because sola scriptura has so little support, at least logically or exegetically from the biblical text, it appears that your preaching, at least from the videos and kind of what you've mentioned here, stems from effectively misrepresenting LDS theology to ignorant Mormons.
Okay, well, I would love to get into more of that, but my phone is about to die. Like, I'm not joking with you guys. Like, it's
no, you're fine.
James, but would you be if we were to do like a follow up? Would you be willing to discuss and have an interaction, say, justification, baptismal regeneration, and other issues about soteriology?
We can talk about soteriology. I think that'd be a great follow up.
Yeah. We'll have to find another time, because
sure.
Okay, sure. I may or may not be finding another job here soon.
No worries.
Yeah, the job I have that left, and now I'm trying to find a new one. I'll maybe get a new one soon. So I don't know what my schedule is going to be like. So,
well, we'll pray and hope that works out for you.
Yeah. So again, like, it was good meeting you, Travis, and Brian.
Robert.
I don't know why.
It's okay. I call him Bobbert sometimes.
Well, I think, is your last name, it's Boblin?
Boblin. It's Irish.
Okay. Yeah. For some reason, I'm further back, so I keep thinking it says like Bryant or something.
Okay. Fair enough.
No worries. And it's probably tiny on your screen.
Yeah, it is. So again, it was good meeting you guys. It was good seeing you.
Elder Hooper. Thanks a lot. Appreciate it.
And cool. So I'm gonna let you guys go before I accidentally hang up on you guys.
No worries. We'll see you. Thanks, James.
We'll see you, man.
Have a good one. Bye. You